And that's sort of what this video is for. It's just, you know, this is what we used to do wrong. We learned by it. Now we're moving on. This is how to do it right.
I'm Peter Kolb, Montana State University Extension Forestry Specialist and a forestry professor. And with me is
Scott Keene, certified forester. My job is setting up timber sales, working with small private landowners, all the way up to large timber companies, working with the mills.
Scott also coaches the Montana logging sports team and is an expert in chainsaw use and logging in general. In this part, we'll be talking about assessing trees that need to be taken out, how to look at the hazards associated with those trees, how to establish where you're going to cut them, how you're going to cut them. Well, when you're holding a chainsaw, you basically have a motorcycle engine with a cutting blade attached to it, and that can cut your leg off in less than a second. So it's very important that you have a proper grip on that saw, you have a proper stance, so when you're holding this, you are a stable platform for the safe operation of that saw.
So the first thing, as we talked about on the first video, is safety gear. Have my chaps on, have my boots, my hard hat, my gloves, my glasses, and the earplugs ready to go.
Important to consider is Scott is a professional. He's done this for over 30 years, and so the techniques we're going to show you today are something that takes time, skill, and experience to learn how to do and do safely. Things you want to look for in your surroundings before you start working with your chainsaw, particularly if you're dropping trees, are cars, structures, vehicles, but more importantly, other people. So Scott, why don't you go look at the tree we're going to drop?
Okay.
So what we're going to do at this point in time is assess the tree that we're going to drop. We want to look at the crown of the tree, the lean of the tree, the shape of the crown, and what's around the tree, any potential hazards that the tree might fall into.
Which way the limbs are leaning, which way the tree's leaning, which way the wind's blowing, and then you sort of pick which way the tree is going to go.
We don't want to try and drop it against the lean, because that would require pushing it backwards, and with most sawing techniques, that's really not possible, and you're creating an unstable tree in that process. When we drop a tree, we want as much wood to work with as possible, because the wood is going to allow us to use leverage to move the tree in the direction we want to move it. So if we move down to the base of the tree here and put an undercut and a back cut in here, we have almost twice the diameter of wood to work with as up here.
First, we'll put in the undercut. The undercut basically gives you that direction that it's going to go. The undercut basically is the steering wheels of how that tree is going to fall. First cut is about a quarter to a third of the way in, not any farther. Then you come up from either the top or the bottom and make that into a perfect wedge. That's called the undercut. You don't want to saw in any farther. That just has to be a perfect wedge.
A critical component of the undercut is that when you do the horizontal cut and the vertical cut, that in the back of the tree, they meet and close together. What we don't want to see is that this horizontal cut goes any deeper than the angled cut on the tree. The reason for this is the purpose of the undercut is not only to direct the tree to fall in this direction, but to preserve the hinge, which will be this part of the tree, as a tree starts to fall over, that hinge is still controlling the fall of this tree. And when this actually closes and the tree is committed at this angle to where it's going to fall, Only then does the hinge break and pop apart, freeing the butt and allowing the tree to fall all the way over.
Biggest mistake people make is they saw the tree completely off. That hinge wood actually controls that tree to go in that direction of the undercut. So as you come in, you leave 1.5 to 2 inches of hinge wood, and those literally fibers are holding that tree in place.
So now that we have completed our undercut, which ends right about here, we want to determine where we are going to place our back cut. The back cut starts from the back of the tree, as the name implies, and will be actually the cut that liberates the tree and causes it to fall over. So Scott is going to take a saw and trace where the undercut would intersect the back of the tree, and then he'll raise his saw up to where the back cut should start, about 2 inches above that undercut. Okay? Now, normally for a right-handed chainsaw operator, the way to do your back cut would be to go on the side of the tree that Scott is on, where you're cutting with the bottom of the blade of the chainsaw. The problem with that is, with this other tree and the stump, there's not a safe space for Scott to operate under. Plus, when you're doing the back cut, you have to consider your escape route. When you're cutting down a tree and it starts to move over or starts to fall over, you need to move away from the base of the tree, because in certain circumstances, this butt, if it breaks the hinge too quickly, will kick out. So your escape route from the back of the tree from when you're sawing, will be at a 45 degree angle backwards away from the direction that the tree is falling. Under no circumstances do you want to move away from the back of the tree in the opposite direction that it's falling, because if a wind gust hits the tree, it can back it over, or if the butt kicks out from the tree, you're in direct line with that. So always off to the side, a 45 degree angle in a previously cleared spot. So before you start the back cut, you want to make darn sure that you have an escape route and that's not all brushed in and it's not full of debris that you're going to trip on. Okay, so we look at this stump. This is actually a pretty ideal cut for dropping a tree. This was the undercut, so it removed about a quarter of the base of the tree. The distance is perfect, so we have a good hinge in here. It's just enough to let the tree tip over, and then when it's committed, then the hinge can break off. The back cut, as you can see, is a good 1.5 to 2 inches above the undercut right here, and that make sure that the tree falls over this way safely, and this piece in here will jam and actually kick the butt free then eventually when it's over. So this would be what we would call pretty much a perfect undercut and a perfect back cut. The hinge is the right thickness for a tree. It maintains enough control of the butt of the tree so the butt can't come loose off of there. And plus, because this tree had a little bit of a lean towards me, the hinge is a little thicker on this side, so that prevents that leverage going towards me from influencing the tree to fall towards me and keeps it going in this direction, which is the direction we wanted it to fall. Now, before Scott dropped this tree, this is an old stump that's been there for about 100 years, but for him to cut the tree, he needed some space. So all he did was cut this stump off, and we moved it off to a safer distance so he had room to maneuver. And one of the key components to dropping a tree is that you can get out of the way. Once a tree has fallen to the ground, there's all sorts of tension in the stem because there's a lot of weight on this tree. So the next step will be to remove the limbs and section the stem into manageable pieces. That might be pieces of firewood, that might be logs for commercial sale. So in this case, what Scott is going to do next is he's going to walk down the stem and he's going to cut off and remove all of the branches that are on the sides of the tree to make access to the main stem better. So this branch is bent over. It wants to be straight, so a lot of tension is right here on the branch. If we cut from this side, it's going to pinch. If we cut on that side, it'll break free. So knowing which side of the tension to cut on is essential to safe operation of your chainsaw. Where you stand in relation to the tree and the limbs is very important, and you'll notice that Scott is standing on the opposite side of the stem from the branches that he's removing with his saw. And he's using both the top and the bottom of the bar of his saw to cut those branches off. Now, as you're walking along the stem, it's essential that you maintain proper footing and look where you're going to step so you don't fall over. Many chainsaw accidents have occurred when someone has fallen with the running saw and the saw falls across his lap. This is, of course, one of the reasons we have the chain brake on the saw as well. Watching where the position of the bar, the cutting end of the saw is also important. It's easy to hit rocks, hit soil while you're doing this. So sometimes leaving the bottom branches is important to keep that main stem off the ground. You don't want to be cutting wood that's laying directly on the ground because there's a high risk of hitting rocks and other debris that can dull your saw or in worst cases cause your chain to jump or break. While sawing, he observed that the log was starting to sag. It starts to sag, that told us that the tension and the pressure was moving that way. So you always want to saw on the opposite side of which the pressure is pushing. So then, contrary to what we originally thought, he then moved the saw to the bottom and cut up. So when the tension pushed the logs down, it opened up the cut and allowed his saw to cut freely. Many chainsaw users will use their equipment to cut dead trees. Dead trees represent a specific hazard because the wood dries out, it loses its elasticity, it tends to break more easily, and as soon as a tree dies, bugs and fungal pathogens will enter it and start to decay the tree, reducing the structural integrity and weakening the entire length of the tree. And this offers a special hazard because when you drop this kind of a tree, there is always the risk that the top can come out of it and fall on you.
This is one of those ones that we showed you how to put a wedge in a tree. You never want to put a wedge in a dead tree. As you're pounding on that wedge, that can shake that top loose and it's coming right down on top of you.
So this portion of the tree was about 30 feet up in the tree. When this was still standing, it was pretty much the same state of decay. We can just pull the punky and rotten wood out of this tree. It's crumbly. It has no structural strength. As soon as we start sawing in the bottom of the tree, that vibration will cause this top to break. And this section alone weighs over 100 pounds. And if it drops 30 feet on top of you, you're dead. But we're in a hurry. We want to get the job done. That is when accidents happen. So when you hear that little voice, your conscience or whatever, telling you to slow down, think about it, or maybe I shouldn't do this, particularly when you're felling trees using a chainsaw, you should listen to that little voice.
Over the years, I've worked in the woods almost 40 years, and in that time, I've actually lost a couple friends who were out falling trees and just one thing or another, you know, made a mistake or the tree fell back and you know, we lost them. So, if you're not experienced and you do not have you know, the right gear and don't feel confident about cutting that tree, it's time to hire a professional.
The purpose of this video was to familiarize the chainsaw user with safe procedures in using that chainsaw and the hazards that might be encountered when running it. This is not a substitute for appropriate chainsaw training.